I mean, all of my ads started to say, like, want to get rid of that belly fat?
Could you share that ad with me, please? Hello, and welcome to Outside the Fox, where we explore what's happening online and why it matters. My name's Ajay Patel.
And I'm Kim Horcher. Today, we are going to be talking more deeply, in fact, about ad blockers.
I guess I already have to ask you, do you use ad blockers?
You know I use ad blockers. Well, you do too, right?
I have a bad history with them, and so I'm still trying to, you know, become more knowledgeable on them. Even since the last episode, I said the same thing.
No, it's good that you're here to learn, because that's what's going to be happening in this episode today. We have a special guest who is going to be talking to us more about ad blockers. What are they exactly? Mm-hmm. What do they do? How do they work? All the ins and outs. Please welcome Scott DeVaney.
Hi, thanks, yeah.
Why don't you explain exactly what you do at Mozilla?
I'm the editorial manager for Firefox add-ons, and basically means I take care of anything related to add-ons content marketing, how they're featured, where they're featured, stuff like that. And I also have the privilege of leading a unique Mozilla project, a community project. We have something called the Firefox Recommended Extensions Community Advisory Board, and it's comprised of folks that just, they contribute their time and talent to helping us curate and select what become our official curated set of extensions.
So I guess to start super basic, what are ad blockers?
The name is pretty good. It's self-explaining, but I think they're actually more. I mean, they block ads, but maybe a more apt description is like a content filter or a content blocker, because you can actually customize most good ad blockers to block not just ads, and how they do that is they have a way of sort of identifying what on a web page are typically associated with advertising and know to filter those out. But they also do things like, you know, annoying autoplay videos. If you go to like some news website, sometimes they have embedded video that just starts automatically playing. That can be filtered out. Or pop-ups or cookie consent banners, that sort of thing. They can also filter those out. So they're ad blockers plus.
What you've described is so apt, because it seems like ads are just ubiquitous. You don't even know you're being served an ad when you're being served an ad. So along those lines, I have to ask, how do ad blockers work specifically?
They basically have usually filter lists, and they know, again, to what to identify on the page and filter out. And so, for example, one thing might be that they can sense pings to an ad server, and they know to filter that out, so no information is going back and forth between whatever's happening on your page and to the ad server. And so that actually, you know, has some privacy benefits baked into it, actually, because not only are some ads just trying to serve you an ad, they're actually also kind of tracking you. Ad blockers can generally sense on the web page where these advertising elements are, and halt any exchanges between them and yourself and the ad servers.
Now, speaking more presently, we've been talking about Manifest V3 for what feels like almost a year at this point. Mm-hmm. And this is a new platform for Chrome extensions that has seen some controversy. Could you talk about what that is?
Well, it's something that I would say was kind of started by Google. This momentum started 2 or 3 years ago, where they wanted to, took a proactive move to evolve the underlying technology that that extensions are built upon, which is basically a suite of APIs. And with that, though, other major browser vendors got together, and it's been very collaborative. So pretty much all major browser vendors are moving into an MV3 world, including Firefox. And in large part, it's a collaboration to find out what are our common use cases. But it's also where we're learning about distinctions. Every browser has different things, different objectives they have with their product. And those can, with the APIs you offer through your manifest, you're allowing developers should be able to do different things with your browser. And so there are points of distinction, but in large part, it's a lot of collaboration and ubiquity.
And I know I've seen that the promise of this is that it should provide better security, but also a drawback could be that a lot of extensions simply won't work anymore.
We basically want to provide developers with as much choice and freedom as possible, which in turn will turn into more choice and freedom for users. So we, Mozilla and Firefox, are going to support both MV2 extensions and MV3 extensions. And I think that's the big deal we're talking about here, because Google has decided to phase out MV2, and that process is underway, and it's kind of a rolling process. So it's happening now, and I think by mid this year, Google may not will stop supporting MV2 extensions, while Firefox will continue to do so. And the effect that's having on ad blockers is some of your more popular ad blockers rely on MV2 APIs, and if those aren't supported, they won't work in the browser. So by supporting MV2 and MV3 APIs, you'll get a broader suite of ad blockers available on Firefox.
I did have a question. We kind of joked about it as we opened the show, where I have a weird history with ad blockers, and I kind of fell for them quite early. It was definitely because of my dad, where he was like, "We have to, just install this on every computer in the house," and then next thing you know, we dealt with more problems than solved. So, what is a good way to kind of choose an ad blocker for myself? Is there, a one size fits all, or is it, a particular trait that I should look for?
Yeah, well, it does kind of depend on what you want to do. I mean, I actually did write a blog post some time ago called "What's the Best Ad Blocker for You?" And it's on our blog on the addons.mozilla.org. There's a lot of great ones out there, and some of them kind of veer into more specialties. So it's hard to know. It really does depend on what exactly you're looking to solve. Are you looking for something that's just like right out of the box, just like plug and play? There's some great ones for that. If you're a little more technically nuanced and you want to get in there and kind of customize, well, they can all kind of do that, but some more than others. And I should add, there's a lot of really neat customization you can do with ad blockers. Like, for example, maybe you don't want to block all ads. Like, there could be certain people on certain social media sites or certain content creators, you actually you want to allow those ads. Maybe you want to support certain folks. You can customize most ad blockers with allow lists, those are called, and stuff like that. So you can tweak them. So I think it really depends on the level of customization you want to get into.
Do you have a bad experience that you could share with the audience about, not using ad blockers that kind of inspired you to be more proactive about using them?
Sure. I mean, there are a few things. I mean, even the FBI a couple years ago actually put out a statement recommending people use an ad blocker because there was at the time a rise in malicious advertising, malvertising, which is
Right.
weird word to say, but like even malvertising. So where there were ads that were doing a good job mimicking trusted big brands and luring people in, which prompted the FBI to even release that statement that it can be a safety measure.
Do you have any stories?
I mean, I've certainly been to websites before and I thought I was reading a news article, and
Right.
then in very small lettering, not at the top, not at the bottom either, actually in the middle, which is odd, it says this is a paid advertisement. And I know that's not something you can exactly block that way, but it does speak to how much we're being served ads
Sure.
all the time without
Yeah.
even knowing it.
And when we probably all noticed, like when these ads hit a little too on the nose. Like I noticed as I was entering middle age, I mean, all of my ads started to say like, you want to get rid of that belly fat? And I'm like, wait a second. A, that's a gross ad. Two, how did you know I'm getting fatter? Like, these things are like, they are legitimately trying to follow your every move and know as much as they
Could
can.
you share that ad with me, please?
No, no, we're not doing this.
Sorry.
Well, I'm very pro ad blocker. AJ is currently undecided, but I'm wondering what are some pros and cons people might consider when picking an ad blocker or not?
Well, other than the obvious advantage of blocking ads, which is probably why you install one, there's a side benefit of usually pages load faster, web pages, because there's less content to load, less images or video to load. So you often get a faster web experience with an ad blocker. In terms of a drawback you might encounter, though it is pretty rare, is sometimes they can break a page. I mean, there may be something that an ad blocker inadvertently identifies as an advertising element, and it's not, and it can break a page. It's rare, but it can happen.
So one thing that kind of keeps me back from things like an ad blocker, a password manager, is kind of the friction I foresee you know, taking on that task, where I see it and it's like, ah, do I really have the time, or do I really want to commit the time to do this? How easy is it to kind of just turn on that practice and turn it into an everyday routine?
I mean, I found that, like, you know, like family and friends that I speak with, and they've all heard of ad blockers, but they don't even know where to start sometimes, of like where to find one, how to install, how to manage it. And it's often like way easier than most, you know, average internet users imagine. So, for example, thinking off the top of my head, if you were to go to addons.mozilla.org, and that's our main platform for discovering for add-ons extensions that work for Firefox, and just search in its search field ad blocker. If you see an orange trophy badge next to a name, that's what's part of our Firefox recommended extensions program. So it's an orange little trophy badge. And I don't know, we have like a half dozen or so, a handful of ad blockers as part of our vetted recommended program. And they're all selected for, because they're diverse and very good at what they do, but they're all very user-centric and generally, you know, generally easy to use. And so find one of those, install it. In most cases, it's simply a matter of just installing it, and then they work right out of the box. You can dig in there if you want to customize. But more often than not, it's simply a matter of finding it, installing it to your browser, and they often work right out of the box.
Much better than the CD I had to install in 2003. So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. That the blog post that Scott wrote, I would check that out. If it's something that's really well vetted, like the official little trophies that I was doing this to off camera when Scott mentioned it, I would definitely look into that. I think it's just a matter of figuring out what works for you and picking something that is agreed upon, especially from an official source, that it's a good choice.
One thing I would add about all of our recommended extensions is it's not just that they're vetted for quality, functionality, performance, they're security reviewed. And this is something that's very unique that we offer with our recommended extensions, that every new version that a developer submits of the recommended extension goes through a line-by-line code review by security experts to make sure it meets our really stringent security protocols and policies.
Scott, thank you for teaching us more about ad blockers, how to find the best ones for us, and good resources.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
To the audience, are you in the practice of using any ad blockers? Please let us know in the comments. I definitely need to have some room for improvement on that.
You have your homework ahead of you, and you know what? It's not going to be that hard, I promise you.
That's all we have for this episode. Subscribe to the channel and be sure to download Firefox, because you know it's the best. We'll see you next time.